Okay, good. So then I will introduce you now. So, okay, so welcome everybody to this math associate seminar. Today, I'm very happy to introduce the speaker, Jorge Antezana from Universidad Nacional de La Plata. He's doing research in harmonic and complex analysis, operator theory, and interactions between analysis and probability. And today he will talk about sampling, tilings, and quasicrystals. So, okay, who is yours?
Okay, thank you very much, Zacharias. Thank you very much for the invitation, for the possibility. I'm very, very happy. As Zacharias said, I want to talk about some relationships between this classical sampling theorem, tilings, and quasicrystals. Let me begin with some preliminaries or conventions. Suppose that we have a Borel set omega in Rd, then I will identify the space L2 of omega with the subspace of L2 of Rd of those elements whose representatives vanish almost everywhere in the complement of omega. I will use this normalization for the Fourier transform with the 2 pi in the exponent of the exponential. So the inverse Fourier transform will be have the same form without the minus here. since it will appear many times throughout the talk, I will use this this notation for the exponentials. I will note this lambda will be the frequency that appear here. When I consider the exponential as an element of L2 of omega, I implicitly assume that it is the exponential is restricted to the set omega. So it is multiplied by the characteristic function of omega. In order to state the sampling theorem, let me recall the definition of the Paley Wiener spaces. Let me take a bounded Borel set omega. Then the Paley Wiener space associated to this set of omega is the subspace of those elements in L2 of Rd whose Fourier transform vanish almost everywhere in the complement of omega. In other words, the Fourier transform of F lives in what I call L2 of omega. Okay, so the Fourier transform, we call that Fourier transform in L2 is isometric and isomorphism. So the Fourier transform here is an isometric isomorphism between the Paley Wiener associated to the set omega and the space L2 of omega. This spaces are the natural framework if you want to work with signals in the nature, for instance, which do not have arbitrarily high frequencies. For instance, if you want to work with the human voice, or if you want to to work with signals that the humans can listen, you don't need to work with the whole spectrum of frequencies. You can restrict your attention to a bounded set of frequencies, and so this is the natural framework, mathematical framework, to work with these kind of signals. Although it is presented as a subspace of L2, inside each equivalent class, there is a distinguished representative that is very regular. If you have an element in L2, the Fourier transform is also in L2, and if omega is bounded, then the Fourier transform is also in L1. And so if you consider this integral by the dominated conversion theorem, this function here is continuous. Moreover, you can derivate this expression, and what you have at the end is that this function is not only continuous, but also is very small. It's an infinity function in Rd. So the elements of the Paley Wiener space can be thought as very regular functions. So you can evaluate the element of the Paley Wiener space in different points, and it turns out that the evaluations are bounded functionals, because if you can rewrite this integral here as in this way, and what you have is that this is an inner product between this function and this other function. And so if you use the properties of a Fourier transform, concretely the Plancher-Lefèvre theorem, you can transform this inner product in this other inner product. And what you get is that the value of f at x can be written as the inner product of f against this function kx here. This function kx is the inverse Fourier transform of the exponential with frequency x restricted to omega. So it is an element in the Paley Wiener space. The norm of kx is equal to the square root of the measure of omega. So in this way, you see that the evaluation is a continuous functional, but also you see that all the evaluations are uniformly bounded. Moreover, all of them have the same norm. Well, this is more or less what I wanted to say about the Paley Wiener spaces, and now we're ready to recall the sampling theorem, also known as Shannon-Whittaker-Kotelnikoff theorem. Now, let us restrict our attention to the real line, and the real line, let us consider the set omega as an interval, the interval minus 1/2, 1/2. So, given an element in the Paley Wiener sub I, then this theorem says that the element, the f of x, can be obtained if you do the sum of the values of f at the different integer numbers combined with this function here, that's the cardinal sign. And this series converges not only in L2 but also uniformly in X. This is a very important theorem in signal processing, because it's the first step to a discretization of your function. Because observe that it's telling you that if you know the function at the integer points, you know it everywhere, because you can combine these values at the integers with these functions here, and you obtain the function everywhere. And for this reason, it's very, very important in applications. Let me recall very briefly the main ideas of the proof of this theorem. The first ingredient, and probably the most important, is that something that probably you remember from the functional analysis course, is that the exponentials with integer frequencies constitute an orthonormal basis of L2 of I. Then, if you take the Fourier of the inverse Fourier transform of these exponentials, you can do the computations, they are not difficult, and you get exactly these functions that appear here, this cardinal sign. Since the Fourier transform is isometric, this orthonormal basis goes to this other orthonormal basis. And so these functions constitute an orthonormal basis of your space. But also, as I said before, if you take the inverse Fourier transform of an exponential, what you get is the reproducing kernel. So this fn that you see here is exactly the inner product between f and this function. And so this sum here is just the expansion of f in terms of this specific orthonormal basis. And so it converges in L2. Okay? So this is the first part. And the second part, the uniform conversion of this series, comes from the fact that the reproducing kernels are uniformly bounded. All of them, in this case, have norm 1. So using, for instance, Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, you can see that the L-infinity norm is controlled by the L2 norm. So the L2 convergence of this series also implies the L-infinity convergence. And so you have the uniform convergence. So if you pay attention to this scheme of the proof, you see that if you want to extend this theorem to more general settings, so to more general sets, or even to RV, some crucial step is this one, is the existence of an orthonormal basis of exponentials in the L2 of this set. Now, the orthonormal bases in general are very, very rigid systems. So this rigidity leads us to consider some alternatives in order to be able to reach much more general sets, because otherwise we can extend this theorem, but only for some specific sets of omegas. So let me recall the definition of risk basis and frames. Well, if you have a family of vectors in a Hilbert space, we say that this family is a risk basis of the Hilbert space if this operator defining the little L2 of the set lambda to the Hilbert space is bounded and inverted. And the operator is defined in this way. What does it mean? Okay, it means that since the operator is invertible, it's surjective. So it tells you that any element of your space can be written in this way, as a combination of the element of your basis. On the other hand, since the operator is injective, this expression is unique. The coefficients to represent a given element of your space is unique. And then this other requirement here, the boundedness, is because you have here a series. It's not like in linear algebra that you have a finite sum. So now you want that if you perturb a little bit the coefficients, you want that the result doesn't differ too much from the original result. So this is the reason why you require the, here the boundedness. So with the boundedness, if you perturb a little bit in the sense of a little L2, then the sum won't change too much. This is with respect to real spaces. And what about frames? Well, look at this definition, and now here is frame. This basis and frames. You see, there is only a small change, and it's here. Instead of asking invertibility, I asked this, the operator be surjective. The idea behind frames is that you are trying to generalize the notion of system of generators that appear in linear algebra. Here, since you are asking surjectivity, what you have is that any element of your space can be written in this way. So in this sense, you are generalizing this idea of system of generators that appear in linear algebra. One nice fact about real spaces and frames, not that any real basis is in particular a frame. The difference is that in the real basis, this expression for it given an F, this expansion of F was unique in the case of risk basis. In the case of frames, we have many different ways to write a given element of your space. But that's a unique difference. So one nice feature of frames, in particular of risk spaces, is that if you have a frame, then any element of your space can be written in this way. Over here you have the sum, and you combine these other elements and G lambda constitute what is called a dual frame, and this elements are combined with the inner products of F against the element of your frame. So it's telling you that if you know this, all these inner products, then you can recover the element F of the Hilbert space. So if you have in some L2 of omega a frame of exponentials now, then you consider these special functions that appear here, the dual frame. If you consider this expansion of the element F of L2 of omega, but now using the frame of exponentials, now you start to do the same as in the proof of the sampling theorem. So you start to use the Fourier transform. And so since these are exponentials, these inner products turn out to be the evaluations of the functions in the Paley Wiener space at the points of lambda, of the frequencies that appear here. In the sampling theorem, what you had here were the cardinal signs, these signs divided by x. Now what you will have is the inverse Fourier transform of the dual frame. But still, see that you can see that you can recover your function everywhere, just knowing the function in these points, in the points of the set lambda, capital lambda. So it's enough to have a frame in order to have this kind of reconstruction scheme for functions in the Paley Wiener. Okay, so now let us try to study when you have in space L2 of omega a real basis of exponential or a frame of exponential. For this, let me recall the two definitions. The first one is the definition of tiling. We say that a set omega, world set omega in RD, tiles RD with translations in a set lambda at level k, if this sum is equal to k almost everywhere. What is this sum? I consider the characteristic function of omega, and I translate the characteristic function of omega using the element of lambda. I sum all these translations, and this sum has to be equal to k almost everywhere. In this case, we say that omega tiles the space, RD in this case, at level k. The level is given here. When the level is one, we simply say that the set tiles the space. We are specifying the level. On the other hand, let me recall that in RD, full lattice, simply a lattice in this talk, is the image of set D through an invertible matrix. So in particular, a lattice is a subgroup of the additive group RD. Given a lattice, there is a notion of a dual lattice. The dual lattice consists of those elements in RD such that the exponential with a frequency mu in this case are lambda periodic. Another way to say the same is that the dual lattice consist of those elements mu in RB such that if you take in a product of mu and lambda, this belongs to the integers for any lambda in capital lambda and then in the original lattice. You can also prove that the dual lattice of this expression is as in the case of the lattice, so it's a lattice, and the inverse in the invertible matrix associated to the dual lattice is this one. It's the inverse of the transpose of the matrix associated to the original lattice lambda. By the way, I never put lambda here. So this lattice here is lambda. So this is a dual of this one. Well, with this definition, let me mention some results about the existence of real spaces or orthogonal bases related with tilings. So consider a lattice in Rb and a Borel set in Rb. Our first result is the so-called Fuglede theorem, and it tells you that you have the exponentials with frequencies in the lattice lambda constitute an orthogonal basis for L2 of omega if and only if the set omega ties the space with the dual lattice. So you have a very nice relationship between the existence of orthogonal basis of exponentials and time. So this late existence of orthogonal basis of exponentials with some properties, geometric properties of the set omega. More recently, there was appeared this beautiful theorem of Grestad and Lev that relates also the existence now of free spaces with K tilings. More precisely, what they proved was that if you have a bounded set, then if this set K tiles the space Rd with a lattice lambda, then there is a real basis of exponentials for the space L2 of omega. This is very nice. The first result where it appears is this relation explicitly between tilings or K tilings and the existence of real basis of exponentials. Before this theorem, Jordi Marzo had proved special case of this theorem where the set omega was a finite union of Qs of equal side lengths. After this theorem appeared, Michalis Konousakis also gave an alternative proof of this. Of this result, and with his method, he was able to say something more about the structure of the result. If you see in both results, we are dealing with lattices. This is telling you that you have a group acting in both situations. When you have a group action on your problem, you know that you can have a reduction in some sense of your problem. And with Elona Bor and Carlos Cabrelli, we studied these problems from this point of view, trying to use this reduction that comes from the fact that you have a lattice acting on your problem. And we get this version of Grestad and Lev theory. We prove that there exist elements A1, AK in Rd such that for any bounded world set omega in Rd such that K tiles Rd with lambda, then the exponentials with frequencies in this shift of the dual lattice, the dual lattice here is shifted by A1 and here A2, A3 and until AK, this system of exponentials constitute the real basis for L2 of omega. So here what you have is that the same K tuple of elements work for any omega that K tiles Rd. And you have here that you can say something about the structure of the risk basis that you get in these spaces. This was also the structure that found Michalis in his paper. On the other hand, this K tuple here are generic in the sense that if you pick them at random in the unit cube, for instance, with probability one, the K tuple that you have chosen will work for this theorem. Using again this structure provided by the lattices, you can prove also a kind of converse of this result, which is this one that tells you that if you have a Borel set, a bounded Borel set in Rd, such that L2 of omega admits a risk basis of this particular form, then the set omega had to k tile the space Rd with lambda. Here you use the dual. And so in this way you close the circle, as in the case of Fuglede's theorem. In the case of Fuglede's theorem, you should remember you had an if and only if. You had the existence of orthonormal basis if and only if you have the tiling with the dual lattice. Here you again have something similar. You have that you have a risk basis with this structure if and only if your set K tiles the space with the dual lattice. In particular, it's telling you that for instance, in the space L2 of a triangle, you cannot find a risk basis with this kind of structure, because the triangle cannot k-tile the plane. There is one important difference between the Fuglede theorem and this theorem here, that is this hypothesis of boundedness. Here we are requiring the boundedness of the Borel set, and this condition cannot be dropped. You can find counterexamples. Although, but that there are some results for unbounded sets found by Diana Carvajal in her PhD thesis, but you have to add some extra arithmetical requirements to the set in order to have a real basis of exponentials like this. Well, this is about risk basis. In all these theorems, you have a lot of structure. What happens if you want just simply a risk basis and you don't care about the structure? Well, we don't know too much about risk basis of exponentials in spaces L2. And here is a list of what we don't know and we know. It's a short list, but just to have an idea, look at, we don't know, for instance, if the L2 of the ball admits a risk basis of exponential or not. Or we don't know if the L2 of the triangle admits a risk basis of exponential. I said that we know that it does not admit a risk basis of exponentials with that specific structure, but without structure, we don't know if we have a risk basis of exponentials. Actually, we don't know if there exists a bounded set in R without risk basis of exponentials. So there are many open problems here. What we know is, for instance, if you take a finite union of Fischer cubes, then the corresponding L2 of this set admit a risk basis of exponential. And this is very deep result due to Gadi Kosman, Shahar Nitzan. And another theorem about places where we know the existence of free spaces is this one about centrally symmetric polytopes with centrally symmetric faces. This is a quite new result here last year, I think, due to but you see, we don't know too much about the existence of free spaces of exponentials. So let us move to frames and see what can say about that. In the finite dimensional setting, we know that if you have a system or generator, it has more elements, or at least the same amount of elements as bases in your space. In this setting, the intuition say that if you have a frame, you have to have more elements than in the case of a basis. But how to formalize this idea? Because both of them have to be countable. Well, one way to formalize this idea is through the Abelian density. Let me recall briefly the definition. If you have a set lambda in RV, let me write in this way, QR of X, in this way I denote the Q of center at X and with side lengths R. And then the upper density is defined in this way. You count how many elements of lambda you have in this cube, QRX, and then you divide by the measure of the cube. And you repeat this with all the cubes in the space and around all the points in RD. And you take, in order to define the upper density, you take the supremum of these quantities, and then you take the limit when the side lengths of the cube tend to infinity. And to define the lower density, you take the infimum of these quantities over all the x in RD, and then you take the limit. You can prove that the limit exists in both cases, and these are called the lower density and the upper Abelian density. And using these densities, you can get the following result due to Landau. Tells you that if you have a real spaces of exponentials for your space L2 of omega, then if it is a real spaces, then both the upper and lower density coincides, and we say that it has uniform density, and we denote it only by d without the plus or minus. And these two densities have to be equal to the measure of your set omega. In the case of Fourier frames, in the case of frames of exponentials, the density of the frequencies, the lower density, have to be greater or equal than the measure of omega. So in this way, you can formalize this intuition that in the frames, you have to have more elements than in a basis. But a natural question that appears here is, okay, in a frame, I need more elements. And in some sense, this lower bound here is a kind of critical value for your density. But can I find frames of exponentials whose frequencies have density as close as I want to this critical value measure of omega? This is very important in applications because remember that I told you that when you go to the sampling theorem, when you go to the Paley Wiener spaces, the frequencies that appear here are transformed in the evaluations of your signal. And so the more points that you have, or the more frequencies that you have in your frame, the more points that you have to sample from your signal. And so the more complicated that will be your device to sample the signal. So you want frames that with the lower density, with very small density, the smallest that you can have. And so this is natural question here. It was proved by Jordi Marzo, that this is actually true, that you can find, given a bounded world set omega, given epsilon greater than zero, then you can find a set of frequencies whose density is the measure of omega is lower or equal than the measure of omega plus epsilon. The exponential with these frequencies constitutes a frame for L2 of omega. So you can find arbitrary frames with frequencies arbitrarily close to this critical value measure of omega. And the proof of the result is very nice. Let me say a few words about the proof. If you have your original set omega, this yellow one, you can approximate the set omega in measure by a set omega epsilon that consists on a union of equal side lengths cubes. And so this set omega multiplies Rd with some lattice. And therefore, by the previous theorems about three spaces, you know that for the L2 of this omega epsilon, you have a three space of exponentials. And the frequencies by the Landau theorem have to have density equal to the measure of omega epsilon. Now, if you restrict this basis of exponential from omega epsilon to omega, what you get is a frame for L2 of omega. And the density of the frequencies is equal to the measure of omega epsilon, can be taken as close as you want to the measure of omega. With Elona Agora and Carlos Tabrelli, we try to mimic this idea in more general settings of locally compact abelian groups. And using more or less this idea of Jordi, we could prove that also in that setting you can find Fourier frames close to the critical density. In other locally compact abelian groups, you don't have cubes, you don't have dilations, so you have some technical problems to exactly the same, but you can try to follow this scheme, and using this idea you can get a similar result in locally compact abelian groups too. Well, now if you see these schemes, if you have a set, if you want to construct a frame for that set, we can use this scheme of Jordi. But what happens if your set change with the time? Suppose that your set evolves with the time in such a way it preserves the measure, but it becomes becomes longer and longer. So the diameter of your set starts to increase. So this scheme here will give you for the different sets, different frames of exponentials. So a question that could appear in this setting is, okay, if I have this domain that evolves with the time in such a way it preserves the measure, but the diameter increases, can I find frame exponential for all these domains appearing in finite time? Can I find a kind of universal frame? Let me be a little bit more precise. It's possible to find a set of frequencies such that the exponential with these frequencies constitute a frame for L2 of omega for every omega such that the measure of omega is lower than the lower density of lambda. This is a requirement that appears in Landau's theorem, perhaps with an extra equality in the case of Landau. But it's possible to obtain this. Well, if you don't add any structure to your set or any other condition, the answer is no. It was proved by Oleski and Ulyanovsky. But if you add some topological condition to omega, like compactness, it turns out that the answer is yes. And this is very surprising. Oleski and Ulyanovsky proved that there exists a set lambda in RD, density is uniform and is equal to 1, such that the exponential with frequencies in lambda constitute an orthonormal basis for L2 of omega for every compact set omega in RD, such that the measure of omega is smaller than 1. 1 here is the density of lambda. Moreover, they prove that this lambda can be taken as a small perturbation of this regular lattice set D. This is very, very impressive result because you have many, many compacts that have very different structures, and it's telling you that the same frame can be used to all of them. Another surprise that appears in this universal problems is that the intuition says that this set lambda have to be without any cannot have a structure. You have to perturb set B in some, let's say, random way. It cannot have some structure because it has to work for many different compact sets. So when we expect to find set without a very rigid structure, but it turns out that you can find universal sets of frequencies, I mean, sets of frequencies such as this, the corresponding exponentials are frames for every compact set corresponding measure with a lot of structure. And this is, here is where appear the connection with quasicrystals. Let me recall the definition of model sets. I want to construct a model set in RD, okay? So I expand RD in n other dimensions. I add n extra dimensions to RD. And so in the Cartesian product of RD times Rn, I consider a lattice gamma. And I say that gamma is in generic position if, when I consider the two canonical projections, Rd, this is R, should be Rn. So both projections restricted to the lattice are injective. And both projections, the image of the lattice, to both projections have to be dense in Rd and Rn. A simple way to construct a lattice in generic position is like this. Suppose that you have R and you add one extra dimension, take the Cartesian product with R, and then in R2 you consider the lattice step 2, and then you rotate it in the irrational portion of 2 pi. Then the lattice that you get is a lattice in generic position and satisfy these four conditions. Yeah? Two injectivities and two density conditions. Well, when you have a lattice in generic position, you can define what's called a model set. So take a lattice in generic position in Rd times Rn, and in Rn, take a set omega that's usually called a window. And the corresponding model set to this lattice and this window is this set here, is the projections onto Rd of all the elements in the lattice whose second projection is in the window. Here is an example. Here the window is this interval here. And so in this light blue part, you have all the elements of the lattice that belongs, whose second projection belongs to this window. And so these are the elements of the lattice that you project to the first space, Rd. And the projection is what's called this model set lambda omega. If you have worked with the Arnold's periodic functions, you will see that this construction has this flavor of Arnold's periodic functions. You can be more precise in this, but I don't want to enter to these details. Let me give you an example instead. Suppose that you take an irrational number, alpha, and you take this matrix, 1 plus alpha minus 1, alpha minus 1. It's an invertible matrix, and so you consider this lattice gamma. You can prove that this lattice is in generic position in R2. So a typical element in this lattice gamma has this form, 1 plus alpha n minus m and n alpha minus m, where n and m are integers. And then we consider the window as window, the interval 0, 1. So the construction say, okay, you have to consider those elements in the lattice whose second projection lies in the window. So the second projection has to be in the 0, 1. So this part here has to be in 0, 1. But since n and m are integers, it's obliged that m have to be the integer part of n alpha. And so if I denote in this way the fractional part of an alpha, what you have is that this model set is n plus the integer, the fractional part of n alpha. And so this is the corresponding model set to this this window and this lattice. And here is a picture of the dots, the elements of lambda omega. I wanted to show you this picture because in some sense you have here another type of tilings. Here, instead of using only one tile, you have two different types of tiles, the light blue one and the orange one. You combine them in an aperiodic way. So these small sets are also related with aperiodic tilings. It's related with the well-known Penrose aperiodic tilings. Here the model sets are the points and the vertices of these polynomials that appear here. They are also used to describe the diffraction patterns of some new materials that appeared in the 80s, which were called quasicrystals. And that's the reason why these small sets sometimes are called also quasicrystals. What is the connection with our problem? Well, the connection comes from this result of Matei and Meyer. First of all, consider a lattice generic position in Rd times R, consider as window interval, and then you can prove that the density of the corresponding model set is uniform and is given by the measure of the window divided by the measure of the lattice. Measure of the lattice is the measure of any fundamental domain of the lattice. For instance, this one, if the lattice has this one. This holds in general, not only for this particular model set. It's always the density is given by the measure of the window divided by the measure of the fundamental domain. But if you take this particular model set where you have increased it only in one dimension and you take this window interval, then what Matei and Meyer proved is this very impressive result that for every compact set, such that the measure of the compact set is lower than the density of this model set, then the exponential with frequencies in this model set is a frame for L2 of K. So this set has this universal property that I mentioned in the theorem of Olesky-Lanowski. And this set is a very structured set. It's not so random. And so this is very, very impressive, and this for me is surprising. Well, to finish, one minute more, let me say that with Matei, Elona Agora, Carlos Cabrera, we try to extend this kind of result to locally compact abelian groups. The theory of sampling can be done in these groups, in some of these groups, with the condition that the dual group has to be compactly generated. These special groups are basically due to the structure theorems isomorphic to this type of group. So this group are isomorphic to D copies of R times L copies of the torus, and here a discrete and countable abelian group. And so many, many results of sampling can be extended to this setting. In particular, lambda can be extended to this setting. The difficulties in these groups comes from this group, from D, because this part is very nice. It's a D group. You can do a lot of analysis here, but this group here is really the source of all the difficulties, because consider this group is just an abelian, a countable abelian group. So it can be, for instance, the rational numbers with a discrete topology, or it can be this Ruffer group, this the Pn root of the unity with P a prime number, with a discrete topology. So it can be very weird. So when I wanted to study these quasicrystals and the model sets and the applications to sampling theory, the first problem that appears is, okay, is there any lattice in generic position in this group? At that time we asked to Meyer if he knew something about this problem. He said that it would be nice to know if every group G has this property. Now, if you extend it with Rn, then inside this Cartesian product you have a lattice in generic position. It turns out that it's not always possible. With Elona, Carlos, and Basarab, we proved that in order to have here a lattice in generic position, then what you need is an if and only if condition that the part here, this discrete part in your group, cannot contain a copy of set p to the power b plus m plus 1 for any prime p. Okay, let me very briefly say a few words about why this very strange condition here. The reason why this condition appears is that if you want a lattice in generic position, the projection has to satisfy the four conditions, two injectivities and the two conditions on dense range. So these conditions implies that there is some isomorphism between part of your group D and part of some R to the power R to D plus N. The problem comes from the elements of D with finite order, because in R you don't have elements of finite order. So the problems that arise from different prime numbers can be split in different places using the fact that the dimension of R as a Q vector space is infinite. So using this fact, you can split the problems of different P's. But when you work with the same P, then you have to pay a higher price to absorb each element of finite order of order P. You have to pay the price of one dimension of one copy of R. And so here you have exactly D plus N copies of R. So until D plus N, you don't have any problem, but you cannot absorb anymore any other copy of any other element of order P. So that's the reason why this condition here. Well, I think that I finish here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Hey, thank you very much, Jorge, for an excellent talk. So, if there are any questions, which I hope there are, you can either raise your hand in the participants list or let me know in the chat that you have a question and I will take you in order. So, let's see. Are there any questions?
Jorge, I may want to ask you the first question then. In this, you mentioned some sorts of results, especially the one that you had the omega epsilon covering the omega, and then you get you get a frame from a raised basis from the omega epsilon. I mean, my question is a philosophical one. In these sorts of results, is there a way that you extract when you send epsilon to zero some sort of precompactness of your object, you know, to have the hope at the end to get the raised basis at the end, or maybe get a better information on the frame that you get for omega, or these are generally very hard to quantify?
Sorry. Could you repeat the question? You know that you have a raised basis for a little bit bigger set, and from that you want to extract some information about the
frame. It was more philosophical. If there are any, if there is any sort of result, or in the line that you go and when you send epsilon to zero, you can extract some compactness argument.
I understand.
On your
it is usually very hard because when you approximate your set when epsilon tends to zero, the problem is that okay, if you have a risk basis, this operator that appeared in the definition of a risk basis was invertible. Mm-hmm. The problem when epsilon tends to zero is that the norm of the inverse of this operator tends to infinity. So when you go to your set, your risk basis are less and less risk basis in some sense. The operators are.
They go to infinity or they may go to infinity? For example, if you know a priori, yeah, your set omega has a risk basis, and if you apply this process with omega epsilon, would you recover the risk basis of your original omega from this omega epsilon risk basis approximations? Would you recover or not?
In that case, I don't know. I was thinking, for instance, in the case of the ball, that the natural, we don't know if there is any risk basis of the ball, and so you can try to approximate the ball by this sets consisting on some union of the squares. But in that case, you have this problem. But if you already know that you have a risk basis in your space, I don't know if you can recover. I don't know what happened in that case.
For example, you mentioned a result where you have a risk basis for a polytope which is centered symmetrically with each face centered symmetric, right? So this one would be an example that you already know you have a risk basis and you could approximate by cubes in this Calderon type decomposition. And then it would be, I don't know, maybe interesting to see if some subsequence along when epsilon goes to zero would converge back to the original risk basis that you had. I mean, this is a philosophical question.
Yes, very nice. Yes.
I like very much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Manuel. So are there any other questions? Okay.
Can I ask something? Or
yes, please. Yeah, absolutely.
Hi, Jorge. So I went to ask you about this. Well, there are all these problems about sets which are more singular, no? Somehow like this Cantor sets.
Uh-huh.
These things work there somehow, or what's the situation now?
Well, that's
weird results now, I guess.
Yes, there are some results in that direction. It is still an open problem to know if, for instance, in the ternary Cantor set, the space L2 associated to the measure, to the ternary Cantor measure. If in that set, in that space, you have a frame of exponentials. As far as I know, for some kind of Cantor set, you know that there exist even orthonormal bases of exponentials, but are very special Cantor sets where that there is an arithmetical relationship between the number of cuts that you do, how many intervals that you keep in each step. For instance, in the Cantor set, you divide the interval in three parts and you take two parts, and so. 2 and 3 are coprimes, and so this made the situation very difficult. Another example is you divide the intervals 0, 1 in four pieces, and you take the first and the third. And you repeat this construction. This is the and in this use in this Cantor set or the L2 of the measure associated to this Cantor procedure, you can find orthonormal basis of exponentials. But yes, and the problem here, one of the problems, I think that there are many problems, but one of the problems is that if you have a risk basis of if you have an orthonormal basis in this, there is no a good notion of density to deal with that. You don't have this like you don't have a Landau theorem, for instance. You have a kind of density that's associated to a half of measure, but it doesn't work very, very well. And so I don't know. At least as far as I know, there is no many things in this direction. You can replace, for instance, frames by other types of Fourier expansions, like effective sequences. And yes, that effective sequences exist in any L2 of a singular measure. They have good properties. But about frames, I don't know. The limit procedures are difficult because you are changing in some sense the dimensions, the half of dimension. If you want, for instance, go from in the ternary concept, you want to, okay, I construct a risk basis for the L2 of you divide the 0, 1 in 3 intervals, and you construct a risk basis for the L2 of the first and third interval. Then you construct a risk basis. You go one step in the construction of a Cantor set, and you construct a risk basis for the first, second, third, and fourth interval in the second construction. And you go in this way. In each step, what you have are risk basis for sets that have Hausdorff dimension one. But in the limit, you go to a set that has another class of dimension. And so this creates a lot of noise. So it's quite difficult to deal with this. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. So is there any last question? Okay, so if not, I would like to thank the speaker again. Thank you very much, Jorge. And next week, we will have Ivaldo Nunes as our speaker. So looking forward to that. And yes, if you would like to answer this poll before you leave, we would be grateful for that. And otherwise, see you next week. So thanks everyone for coming. Bye.